All right, there are two types of errors that you can make in a lab environment. And one is called a random error, and one is called a systematic error. Both of these are possibilities in your experiments, and it's important that you understand the difference between random and systematic errors. All right, random error occurs once, right? And it might affect one measurement, one trial. So for instance, if I've got my beaker in my hand, and I'm walking over to the balance, and I want to measure its mass, and I sneeze into my beaker, right? That was a random error, yes? Because the probability of me sneezing in trial two's beaker is pretty low. I mean, unless I've got like some severe allergies going on, right? The probability of me repeating that error more than once is pretty slim. A random error causes one trial to be goofy, right? So if I have my beaker that I sneezed into, and I still use that beaker for the rest of my experiment, all my values are probably going to be slightly off. That's why I do my experiment more than once, right? To minimize the effect of those random errors, things that happen that you don't really have any control over. If in trial two, you're walking to the beaker, I mean, you're walking to measure your beaker's mass, and you slip and fall and you drop it. Oh, now I'm in trouble, right? That's a random error. That's probably not something that you were intending to happen, and it probably won't happen in future trials either. And random errors are just things that happen, right? Life happens. Whereas a systematic error would affect all your measurements. Okay, so let's pretend that that balance that we were talking about, according to Nasleth, it wasn't calibrated correctly. Right? Let's pretend that it was off by 10%. Every single mass measurement you make is going to be off by 10%. You see the difference between random error and a systematic error? Right? A systematic error is affecting every single piece of data that you gather. Whereas a random error, it'll affect one trial. Hopefully it won't affect the other trials, right? A systematic error is going to affect every trial you do. Unless you figure out, oh my goodness, the balance is off by 10%, let me go fix that, right? Do we see the difference between random errors and systematic errors? Yes. These are both things that you're probably going to see in the lab. Well, you're definitely going to see random errors. And hopefully you won't see too many systematic errors. That's why we take special care to always calibrate our equipment. But these are things that are possibilities. All right, so here's some data with a lot of random error in them, right? Let's pretend you're measuring mass of water, okay? And this dashed line right here, that's where 25 is, okay, just as a reference point. So trial one, you got 24 grams. Trial two, you got 26.5 grams. Trial three, you got 25.5 grams. Trial four, you got 24 grams, it looks, right? That's a lot of variation. Yes? That's a lot of random error. So hopefully your data are not going to look like this. If your data look like this, that's not a good thing. Okay? Let's talk about two other words you may or may not have heard in the past, and sometimes they're even used interchangeably, so we need to make sure we clearly and thoroughly define them. Accuracy versus precision. Okay, accuracy is how close your measurement is to the true value. Now I say true value because is any measurement perfect? Can you ever make a perfect, 100% error-free measurement? No, right? I have my true mass, there's my true mass, but if I measure my mass, it's not gonna be a perfect, accurate, perfectly accurate measurement, right? I'm gonna have some error. So there's my true mass, whatever that value is, and I don't even know what that value is. Accuracy is how close I am to that true value. Now, sometimes you do know what the true value is, and I'll show you an example of that in just a minute. Precision, on the other hand, is how close your trials are to each other. So, for instance, how repeatable are you? Are you getting the same value in trial one that you got in trial two and trial three and trial four, right? Precision showing how repeatable you are. So that previous data set I showed you, that wasn't very precise, right? It's all over the place. 24, 26, 25.5, they were all over the place. That's not very precise. Do we understand the difference between accuracy and precision? Accuracy is how close you are to the true value. Precision is how repeatable your data set is. Are your data all over the place, or are they in a really close little cluster where you can see them all right there nice and neat? Do you see the difference between these two? Give me a second. Jot those down. Any questions on this accuracy and precision? All right. Let's look at some data. Let's pretend that I'm trying to calibrate my balance, for instance. And I've got a bar that I know it's exact, or I know it's pretty close to exact mass. It's 25 grams. All right, so I put this bar on the balance in a trial one, I get 25, looks like 25.1 maybe. Trial two, 25.1. Trial three, that looks like maybe 24.9. Trial four, maybe 24.95. Right? Those are very, very close to the true value. Right? So that would be both precise and accurate, because if the true value is 25, and these two are slightly above, these two are slightly below, right? When I average them out, they're going to be really darn good. But each one of these are very close to the true value, and they're all hovering within the same area. Does this make sense? I'm both precise and accurate. Here's an example of precision but not accuracy. If the actual mass is 25 grams, and trial 1 I get 27, and trial 2 I get 27, and trial 3 I get 27, and trial 4 I get 27.1, right? I'm repeatable. I'm very repeatable. I'm being very precise. Every trial is very close to each other, but I am not at the true value. Do we see the difference between precision and accuracy? Right? Precision means how repeatable you are. And just because you're precise doesn't mean that you're accurate. If I'm throwing darts, and every time I hit the wall in the same spot, that's not the bullseye, right? That would be precision, but it wouldn't be accuracy. Okay? Do we understand the difference there? So here are some data. And this is an experiment that I do with the elementary school kiddos. I go out to the science club and we do experiments with them. The elementary schools, twice a year. And this is an experiment that we do in March. We go out for Pi Day, right? Pi, 3.14, so we go out in March. We do this experiment where the kiddos calculate the value of pi, right? Pi's value is 3.14 to two decimal places, yes. And so they take, usually a cookie, right? And they measure the circumference, measure the diameter, and then they calculate pi, okay? Now, these are not real data. These are just simulated data I just made up. And then they go write their number on the board. Now, let's pretend that you're doing this with this class. Let's not pretend we're doing this with second graders, because usually the values that the second graders come up with are just like crazy. Some of them are like 0.6 and some of them are like 10, right? Because there's a lot of experimental error when it comes to measuring the circumference and measuring the diameter when you're 7 years old. So let's pretend we're doing this experiment here in class. I decide to be nice and give everyone cookies and say, all right, figure out pi. Student A comes up with this, right? They're student A's data. 3.15, 3.11, 12, 14, 13. So the average value is 3.13. Here's student B. 3.29, 2.87, 3.75, 2.99, 4.01. Average value is 3.38. Which data set is better? I don't think it takes a whole lot of deduction to figure out which one's the better data set, right? This student, average value is very close to the true value, and there's not a whole lot of variance in that data set, correct? This is the one that we're hoping is your grade. This one's average value, I mean, 3.14, that's not great, though, 3.38, especially if we're talking about college students. If we're talking about a 7-year-old, hey, that's awesome. If we're talking about a college student, that's not so great. Right? There's a lot of variance in that from the true value. Do we understand the difference here between accuracy and precision and what that would look like in your data? All right, so now comes every student's favorite, significant figures. Wah-ha-ha. All right, significant figures. If this is something you've never seen, get ready, right? And if you've done this before, sorry. All right, this is something that a lot of students struggle with, so I really want to take time, go through it carefully, go through it slowly. All right, the purpose of significant figures ties all to accuracy in measuring, okay? Remember, accuracy is how close you are to the true value, yes? And your measurement is only as good as the tool you use to make that measurement, right? If I use a really lousy piece of equipment, garbage in, garbage out, right? If I use a really accurate piece of equipment, I'll get really good data. Significant figures are our way of reporting the accuracy in your experiment, okay? So let's look at these two temperatures, thermometers. I've got two thermometers here, and I'm reading the temperature. One of them is in 32, 32.1, 32.2, 32.3, 32.4, that's in ones. And this one, that's in, let's see. Oh wait, excuse me.
That's 32, 33. And this one is in 30, 40, so that was in twos. There you go. All right, so when I'm looking at this one, I can get two decimal places versus one decimal place, right? Because when you're making a measurement, there's always the values that you are 100% confident in. I know it's at least 32.3, and now I'm gonna guess. It's looking like it's maybe 32.3 and a third. Okay, so that last decimal place is always estimated. Whereas in this one, I know it's 32. I'm not sure if it's 32.1 or 32.5, right? That last decimal place, you're always estimating. And that last decimal place is the one that's always subject to interpretation. So you and your lab partner might disagree on what that last decimal place needs to be if your vision's better than your lab partner's, or vice versa. So the piece of equipment that I use to make the better measurement obviously needs to be reflected in the value that I report. Okay? So why do we have significant figures? The whole purpose is to tell other people, did I measure this accurately or did I not measure it accurately? Okay? And we're going to be doing an experiment next week where you figure out the accuracy of glassware. You're going to be using beakers, graduated cylinders, burettes, and all sorts of great stuff. So let's just demonstrate that real quickly. All right. This is a 50 mil beaker. This is a 100 milliliter graduated cylinder. I don't have a burette in the drawer right here. But burette will be the third one you'll be looking at. Okay. The tick marks on this graduated cylinder are in ones. So if I fill it up to 50 right on the meniscus, this is measured in 20s. So 50 isn't even labeled. 50 just means fill it to the top. What's your definition of the top? What's your lab partner's definition of the top? That's a little bit of a gray area, right? So which one of these is going to give me a better data? Right? Obviously it's going to be this one, yes? There's very little interpretation in terms of getting it to 50. Now 50.3, that's a little tougher, right? So that's what we'll be doing next week in lab. We're going to be doing accuracy of glassware. And we'll be using density to figure that out. Now let's talk about how many sig figs are in a measurement. We have to pay really close attention to these rules. And if you've never done sig figs before, you need to especially watch this part, okay? So the first rule is the easiest rule. If it's not a zero, it's significant, right? Any digit that's not a zero, it counts. It's a significant figure, okay? So for instance, if I give you that value of 112.1 and I ask you how many sig figs are in this value, there are four significant figures, right? All of those are not zero. So the sig fig rules for non-zeros are very easy. Any value that's not a zero is significant. So 112.1, that value has four sig figs. Now, when things start getting hairy is when zeros get into the picture. So a zero that is in between a non-zero digit, that would be significant as well. So 305, for instance, has three sig figs. That zero counts as a significant figure because it's sandwiched between two non-zero digits. So the first two rules are the two easiest ones. The next two rules are the ones that students have the most trouble with. Change here so that we can see our screen a little bit better. Because if you're going to watch this later on for the help, it's not going to benefit you very much if everything's out of focus.
Will that be in your way if it's
right there? A technical system here. Don't tell anyone in radio TV that I do this. That's much better. Oh boy. Okay. All right, this value, 50.08, has four significant figures as well, right? Because these zeros are sandwiched in between non-zero digits. Now,
zeros to the left of a non-zero digit are not significant. A zero to the left. Okay, you have to pay attention if it's a zero to the left or if it's zero to the right. A zero to the left of a non-zero digit is not significant. And here's why. Look at this example. Okay, in this value, 0.0023, let's pretend you put something on the balance. My balance is back there, are good to four decimal places. You'll get four decimal places from the analytical balance. And let's pretend you put something on the balance and it says 0.0023. Which values are actually being measured? It's the two and the three, right? These values are actually being measured. These zeros are just placeholders. They're just telling you, hey, there's nothing there. There's nothing there, okay? What's the actual measurement? It's the non-zero digits. These, we call them like a leading in zero, okay? They're not significant. When you write this number in scientific notation, it becomes 2.3 times 10 to the negative third, right? Those zeros go bye-bye. They are not retained as part of the measurement because they're not actually anything you've measured. They are just placeholders, and that's it. All right? Do you understand why these values don't count as sig figs? Yes. This one has only one sig fig. Insignificant. They are not actually measured values. These zeros here are just placeholders, right? What value did I actually measure? I actually measured that one. That's the only thing I measured. The rest of those are leading in zeros. Okay, the next one. Zeros to the right. Zeros to the right of a non-zero are significant if a decimal is present. You need to underline this part. If a decimal is present. Excuse me. Zeros to the right are significant if a decimal is present. This one's going to be the one that gets most students in trouble. I see most students have issue with this rule right here. So we need to spend the most time talking about it. The reason why zeros to the right matter especially comes into play when we're talking about volume measurements. Okay? So for instance, if I've got 1.200, those zeros to the right, okay, those are measured values. Those are measured values. If I put that on the analytical balance, now mine actually goes to four decimal places. That is a measured value, and that is a measured value. That's not a placeholder. Okay, a placeholder is just telling you, hey, this is empty space, and I don't have anything to put here, so I'm putting a zero there. Whereas this is an actual measured value. Okay, this one really, really, really bites in the rear end when it comes to volume measurements. Okay? In lab, next week when we do our volume experiment, when we're measuring the accuracy, 25.00, okay, milliliters. That would be a volume that you would read off of a burette, right? Because the burette is in 0.1s. So there's 24.7, 24.8, 24.9, 25.0. Okay? If the meniscus is right there, remember, these are the ones we know for certain. This is the one we're approximating. And if our eyeball looks at it and the meniscus is right on that line, that's where the 25.00 comes from. That's a measured value that I am confident in. Okay? Now, if I'm looking at my beaker, for instance, which is measured in 20s or 10s, depending on the beaker, okay, you're not going to get 25.00, right? Your volume's just going to be plain old 25. No zeros. You can't get decimal places from a beaker. A beaker's not accurate. Most beakers even say, on the beaker itself, plus or minus 5%. Okay? Those zeros to the right are significant only if there is a decimal place. Does this make sense? This is the one that gets students in the most trouble. Now, if there's a zero to the right in a number that does not have a decimal, then that zero is not significant. It was not a measured value. So for instance, 100 with no decimal place. This is another example of a volume. If you take out your beaker, here is a 250-ml beaker, and it has 100 on it. By the way, this beaker says plus or minus 5% on it. And I fill it to 100, right? Is that actually 100.00? Probably not, right? I have no way of getting a decimal place on a beaker. It's just not possible, right? It's just not possible. So if I was measuring volume using a beaker, sometimes you don't need it to have two decimal places. That's okay. Sometimes it's just an approximate value, right? Just put enough water in it to dissolve. Who cares what that volume, if it's 99 or if it's 103, who cares, right? You're just getting enough to get your salt to dissolve, for instance, right? Here's a place where we don't need it to be super accurate. A beaker is never going to be something you use for accuracy. If you're like, man, I need this value to be top notch, don't reach for the beaker. And our data will confirm that next week. If the beaker, you can't get decimal places. And so if you write an answer as a volume of as 100.00 and it came from a beaker, that's grossly inaccurate, right? Because there's no way of knowing if this is 100 or if it's 103, right? Because this is measured in 25s. That's what this one is, okay? So no decimal place means I think it's 100, but it could be something else. It could be 97. Who knows? 100 with a decimal place, for instance, that is significant. Those zeros do count because that decimal tells me, yes, I know it's 100. All three of those are measured with great confidence. Okay? Do you understand the difference between 100 with a decimal versus 100 without a decimal? And the time that this gets you into trouble is when students have to round their answer to the correct number of significant figures. Do I round it to one sig fig or do I round it to three? If I'm rounding my answer to one sig fig, I would round it this way. If I need to round my answer so that it has three sig figs, I'd round it this way. And we'll talk about the rules for rounding in just a second. But first, we have to make sure we understand how many sig figs are in a number. So is this, we good on this one? This one's probably the toughest one. Okay, so let's just shout out our answers here when you feel brave. How many sig figs are in this number? Four sig figs, good. Oops. How many are in this one?
Four.
How many are in this one?
Three.
Three. And how many are in this one? Four, right? Not insignificant, not significant. Yes, 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 yes. Why does this zero on the end count? What makes this one significant? Because there's a decimal. These are never going to be significant. All right, let's do one more just for good practice. How many sig figs are in this number? Three sig figs. What about here?
Four.
Four. What about here?
Three.
Three. Just these. These are all placeholders. What about in D? That's four sig figs. Good. What about E? One. Why is it only one sig fig? There's no decimal. Good. And how many are in F? Four. Good. I think I've got the answers on that one. Yeah. Do we all understand how many sig figs are in a number? Like this is an important skill. All right. So like I said, the purpose of significant figures is to tell others, what piece of equipment did I use? Was I being accurate or was I being sloppy? Okay. And so, again, your sig figs come directly from what you're using. You don't just arbitrarily decide, I want this number to have five sig figs. That's not how it works, okay? Your sig figs come from the piece of equipment you're using. Now, a lot of times, and when I say a lot of times, I mean all the time, we're not just gonna measure a number and be like, well, I measured that, I'm done, right? When we do a measurement, we're gonna do something with it. Specifically, we're gonna do a calculation, right? Adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing, logarithm, square root, etc. Not going to do too many square roots, but we are going to do everything else. Okay? So, we have rules for calculations involving significant figures. The reason why is, maybe I'm using one piece of equipment to measure mass. and one piece of equipment to measure volume. And the accuracy of the mass is not the same as the accuracy of the volume, right? They're two different pieces of equipment. My final answer for density is only as good as my worst measurement, right? So if I measure mass really, really well, and I measure volume really, really poorly, my final answer is gonna be kind of lousy, right? Because I'm only as good as my worst measurement. That comes from these rules. So let's talk about the rules for adding and subtracting first, okay? The rule for addition and subtraction is that you add, so you punch it into your calculator just like you normally would, and then you round your final answer to the least number of decimal places. Least number of decimal places. I'll give you a second to jot that down, and then we'll go through some examples. All right, here's some examples for addition and subtraction. My first number has 2 digits. My second number has 3 digits. My third number has 3 digits. Which one's my worst measurement? The one with 2 digits. So I punch it into my calculator like I normally would, and then I round it to 2 decimal places. I've got about 60 seconds worth of filming left. So I'm gonna skip ahead to multiplying and dividing, and then I'll come back and let you see some examples, okay? Because I want my video to contain multiplying and dividing. And then I'll go back to adding and subtracting for you guys, okay? So for multiplication and division, you do your arithmetic like you normally would, punch it in, and then you round your final answer to the least number of total significant figures, total sig figs. Okay, the reason why for multiplying and dividing it's total sig figs is because those errors propagate more rapidly when you're multiplying versus when you're adding, okay? When you're multiplying, you got that error, it's gonna expand a lot faster. So that's why you're round to the total number of sig figs. So here's an example, 1.4 times 8.011. This number's got 2 sig figs, this one's got 4. So that's what my calculator gives me. And so my final answer is 11. Right? Not 11.2154, because that's more accurate than my worst measurement. Does this make sense? I'm about to run out of film here, so I'm going to stop.